इन अ सेकेंड। हेलो एंड वेलकम टू द सेकेंड फेसबुक लाइव ऑफ आईनेट। इन दिस टाइम्स वी हैव डिसाइडेड टू गो अहेड विद दीज फेसबुक लाइव्स एंड यू विल सी सच फेसबुक लाइव्स ऑफन फ्रॉम द आईनेट ऑफिशियल फेसबुक पेज। टुडे वी हैव विद अस अ वेरी रिनाउंड ट्रेनर एंड टीचर, डॉक्टर धर्मेंद्र शेठ सर। He is from Surat, Gujarat. He is the founder of Fluent Lingua Language Training and Research Center in Surat, and he is member of the advisory board of LTIS and CIFIL Symbiosis Pune. He has done his diploma in electronics and radio engineering, and then he finally did his PhD in English. And he holds the TESOL Core Certificate Program (CCP) from Wisconsin University, US. And he has also done grammar courses 1 and 2 of TESOL International, US. He has a very vast exposure of industry and the teaching and training sector. He has worked as he has worked for GNFC in Bharuch and for L&T in Hazira. He has been to foreign a couple of times. He has been to the United States of America on American government's invitation. He attended the TESOL conference in Seattle, US, and visited institutes run by the University of California in 2007. And he visited the United Kingdom as a special guest of the British Council and presented a research paper at the ITFL conference in Brighton that was in 2011. He has done a range of professional development works, like he is a founder member of erstwhile LTEX, an online association for teachers of English run under the auspices of the British Council. He is ex-national vice president of LTI from 2008 to 2013. He is the ex-editor of Journal of English Language Teaching, JELT, published from Chennai. He was the ex-editor from 2013 to 15. He is ex-member of Academic Committee, Southern Gujarat Chapter of Commerce and Industry. And he has presented numerous papers and conducted workshops at many national and international seminars and conferences. He was there at the 5th International INET Conference held this year in January at Hyderabad and participated in very enlightening panel discussion. He is a well-known teacher trainer and corporate trainer. He has a vast classroom training experience. He had worked with Department of English, South Gujarat University, Surat, conducted about 100 workshops on communication skills for corporate and academic clients, prepared numerous students for examinations such as IELTS, TOEFL, and BEC. He has trained employees of SR Steel, SR Projects, Adani Port, Vodafone, Larsen & Toubro, Luthra Dyeing, NJ India Invest, Omnova Industries, and many more. He has published some books which are very well known, like Monsoon, English for Everyone from Cambridge University Press in 2019. He co-authored that book. Then English Basics, that's a Flashstone publication. English Ahead, English Edge, and ELWA, that is English Language Workshops for All. All these are four are published by Flashstone only recently, last year. He can be contacted on his Instagram page or his institute, that is Fluent Lingua in Surat. So great to have you with us, sir. Dharmendra sir, are very happy.
My pleasure.
Sir, you can begin.
Fine. So thank you very much, Nadeem, for this introduction. It was a little scary. I sometimes get a feeling that I should retire now. Well, let me share my presentation. Yes. Okay, so first of all, thank you very much, INET, the entire team of INET. It's nice to be with teachers, member teachers again. As Nadeem mentioned, I was there at the national conference last year at Hyderabad, and I had some wonderful time there. Well, today, I'm not able to see all the participants except those who are on this Zoom, but I'm sure there are many friends of mine, colleagues, they're all attending today's program. Now, different people attend such sessions with different goals. So what's your goal? Some of you might know what's going on the other side of the fence. For example, if you are in a formal sector, then you might want to know what's going on in the private sector, so far as the teaching of English is concerned. So I will not disappoint you. Some of you may be looking for errors in my English. I will not disappoint you either. And some of you who may plan, you may be planning about what to do after this lockdown is lifted. Should you continue with the same job or should you start your own private enterprise? So I will not disappoint you. Now, suppose INET team tells me to make a presentation just in one slide, then my presentation will be something like this. This summarizes the entire presentation, actually. If you plan to start teaching, you know, if you want to start your own center to teach English, then what challenges will you face and what are the opportunities? So to my mind, two main things. One, the challenge is financial security. How do you manage your finances? And especially when you are not able to work or when you plan to retire, then what is your financial security? How will you manage your home and family? So that is one of the challenges. And the opportunity is probably you might have earned enough so that you don't have to worry about your pension. So that summarizes the entire thing. Now, what are the contents of today's presentation? I'll be talking about Make Half. Some of you might have heard this particular book, Hitler's autobiography, My Struggle. So I'm going to talk about my struggle. As Nadeem mentioned, I am an engineer turned teacher. So some of the aspects of my journey I'll share with you. As is the case with every field, in our ELT also there are many myths. So I'll try to bust some of the myths. And in any discussion in our field, in academia, we talk about three M's: man, method, and material. So man means the teacher and men, students. I'm going to talk about both. I'll talk about study material and also method. And at the end, we'll have, I think, for 10-15 minutes, a question answer session. And those who are watching this on Facebook Live, we have moderators there. They'll be looking at your comments. So if you have any question, you can post it there. And the duration is 35 minutes for me, and after that we'll have question answer session. Now, since Nadeem has given my information, details about my work and everything, education, so I'm not going to repeat that. We'll directly go to the presentation. Only one line probably I would like to tell you, that I spoke my first original sentence in English at the age of 23. Till that, I had no English. I was a student of a vernacular medium school. That means I studied via the vernacular. Gujarati was my medium of instruction at school. And till 23, probably I never had to use English. So I never bothered about it. But then things changed and I acquired the required qualifications and became a teacher of English. And I was lucky to get a chance to teach in the private sector as well as in the formal sector. Now, largely, if I see my 25 years of career, I was mostly self-employed. Now, why did I become self-employed? Now, right from the beginning, during our engineering, we had some subjects related to entrepreneurship. And at that time, I had a belief that entrepreneurs are happier. So that was a belief. I didn't have any proof, but I kept on experimenting. And later on when I studied, even today, for example, if you Google and if you find out about happiness and entrepreneurship, then you will find a lot of data suggesting that those who are entrepreneurs, they are happier and healthier. So I got a lot of support from the US-based journals and UK-based journals. And I'm sure it is very easy to find such things on Google. I also got a kind of a chart. You can see on the screen. You don't have to read the names of the countries. But on the whole, you can see that on the left-hand side, y-axis, we have happiness score. And on the x-axis has global entrepreneurship index score. So you can see that countries where there is more entrepreneurship, people are generally happier. Now this is, let me make it very clear, this is an old data, but I don't think there is much of a difference in the recent data. And you can see the position of India at the bottom. It was just about 5.5. So probably that motivated me to go to the private sector. Now, with that background, let me start our today's topic. I'm going to talk about the teaching of English in the private sector. And if I want to talk about that, I will have to compare it with the teaching of English in the formal sector, right? Now, when I say the private sector, throughout my presentation, I am going to refer to spoken English classes. I'm sure every city, every town has spoken English classes. In fact, in my probably 1 kilometer area around me, there'll be about six, seven classes teaching spoken English. So that is what I mean by the private sector. Then the second is IELTS, TOEFL, PT, and other examination. There are coaching centers for that. So I'm going to talk about them. And there are quite a few private trainers teaching different kinds of courses, presentation skills and spoken English, business English, ESP generally we say. So this is what I'm going to refer to when I say the private sector. And I'm going to exclude certain things. One is the units of the private sector where textual English is taught, because that will be more or less similar to the formal sector teaching in schools and colleges. So I'm going to exclude them. And I'm going to exclude five-star elite top-class schools where everything is hunky-dory, everything is fine. So I'm going to exclude that part. Now, if I have to compare two sectors, then I will have to talk about, first of all, teachers, because we are all teachers. So let's begin with teachers. Now, in the private sector, anyone with a reasonably good command of English or better than the people around that person can become a teacher of English. Whereas in the formal sector, you require proper certificates and also merit, right? The selection of teachers is on merit, ideally. Then in the private sector, whatever may be your first degree, whatever may be your qualification, whatever may be your field of study or experience, but you can become a teacher of English. So there is no uniformity. Everyone is driving their vehicle in their own way. Whereas in the formal sector, there are standard qualifications that you are supposed to have. For example, if you want to become a teacher of English in a higher secondary school, in Gujarat, for example, then you must have a master degree, you must have a BEd. So there is, and if you have your first degree in English, then only you can become a teacher of English. So in the formal sector, there is a lot of uniformity. There is some standard maintained. Then on the other hand, in the private sector, because teachers come from different backgrounds, they are not familiar with, generally not familiar with the methods of teaching. They are not familiar with many aspects of linguistics, for example, phonetics and syntax. So they are willing to experiment different kinds of things. They are not limited to certain fixed ways of doing. Whereas sometimes we see that in the formal sector, because teachers are taught in a particular way, they study in a particular way, they study similar books. In the BEd also, they have some fixed methods. So because of that, they generally do not deviate from the path that others have followed. So that is sometimes limitations. Obviously, there are exceptions on either side. Then one of the major things in the private sector is teachers' income is directly proportional to students' results. That means if students do not perform well, teachers are going to suffer financially. Whereas in the formal sector, in schools and colleges, your income will remain the same irrespective of students' results. Another problem with teachers in the private sector is they have to do a lot of marketing. They have to get students. Whereas in the formal sector, no marketing is required. You get students automatically every year. Quality is very important in the formal, in the informal sector, private sector, because without that you will not survive. So CPD, Amol's and Krishna's favorite topic, continuing professional development. I don't know whether Amol is watching this session, but he has done tremendous work on this particular subject. If you have any query, you can directly ask him. Continuing professional development. So CPD in the private sector is a compulsion. It is a matter of survival. They have to keep upgrading themselves. Whereas quality in the formal sector is a matter of choice. For example, today when all of you are attending this session, it is a matter of choice. You are doing it for yourself. There is no external force, but you want to improve yourselves. And that's why you are attending this session. These and many other sessions like this. So CPD is for survival in the private sector, whereas in the formal sector, it is joie de vivre. That means you get a feeling of happiness, and that's why you do that. Now, let's go to study material. I'm going a little faster because I have 35 minutes. But if you have any questions, you can always ask via Facebook chat box. Now, study material. In the private sector, teachers are free to decide whatever material they want to use, any material under the sun. And what to teach is also up to them. And that is a very crucial matter. Whereas in the formal sector in schools and colleges, you have a prescribed syllabus, you have textbooks, and you don't have a choice in that. You are forced to. I don't think more than 5% teachers who are watching this have a freedom to decide what to teach and what material to use. So most teachers in the formal sectors, they're bound to use the material prescribed. Not only that, apart from the material, even the activities. In the textbook, whatever is given, school and college teachers will have to teach. If they don't teach, there may be complaints also. And the examination is also based on that. Whereas in the private sector, you can carry out any kind of activity, right? And that's very important actually when we talk about communication in the larger term. In fact, that term reminds me, in the name of communicative language teaching, what I have noticed in the last 10 years or 15 years maybe, there is a lot of dilution in the study material. In fact, that is a matter of another Facebook live. But the main point is that there is a lot of freedom in the private sector. And another point is, in the private sector, most teaching of English is done via worksheets. So it is worksheet-based teaching. And because it is worksheet-based, there is a lot of suspense. And suspense is a major, major element. In fact, I'll spend some time on this particular point as a side dish. Whereas in school and colleges, teachers have a fixed textbook. So every day they have to go with the same textbook, open to page number 25, the same method of teaching. So there is rarely any element of suspense. And in fact, as a side dish, as I mentioned, let me give you some information about a minor research that I carried out a couple of years ago. I wanted to know what students expect from teachers, what students expect from an English language teacher or that classroom. So I made a list of about 25 points after discussing with students. And then I asked them to rank those things in, say, top seven. So what are the top seven things that you expect from teachers in an English language classroom? And I asked that question to about 1,000 students. And then I was able to find out seven essentials of teaching. In fact, I wrote an article on that and it was published. But just as a side dish, if you can spend just 1 minute and think about what those seven things can be. The fourth one I have already mentioned, S for suspense. What are the other things likely? You can just think about that for a half a minute or so. Okay, we are not face to face, so I cannot ask you to tell me, but if you are using Facebook Live, you can write in the chat box whatever you feel like. Seven essential things that students expect from teachers. Okay, now let's go to the next slide. There is nothing right or wrong about your answers, but I'm going to share with you the list that students suggested, seven essential traits. So first was a smile. If a teacher doesn't have a smile, we don't like to study. And mind you, these are seven essentials from students. And students of standard, I think 5 to 10, they were asked this question. So they wanted smile, action. They wanted students to be involved in some activity. Then humor. Without humor, nobody likes to learn. Even I don't like to learn. Suspense, challenge. And I was surprised to find, you know, after the data, after getting the answers from students, I used to interact with them. And many, even mediocre students, they said that we wanted something challenging. We want some challenge every time. And then feedback. One of the chief complaints from students was, teachers, they give project work, for example, some assignment, and students write, say, one page, two page material. And teachers just used to tick mark, right or wrong, that's it. So on the whole, right mark, right that. Or 10 out of 10, say 5 marks, 7 marks. So they were not happy with that. They wanted individual feedback. Now we know that every time it is not possible in the formal sector. And reward, they wanted some reward. It's not necessary that we give them a gift as a reward, but some sort of statements, appreciation. So these are the seven elements. We will refer to them during our presentation. So we talked about teachers. We now talk about classroom. All these images are from the net. On the left-hand side, the image is my classroom. And on the right-hand side, you know who. Now, if you compare classrooms, then in the private sector, usually the number is 20, around 20, maximum 25. Whereas in the formal sector, I have to be politically correct, I have written here 40. But I'm sure you know there are many schools and colleges where the number is beyond 70. Now you can imagine if you have such a large group, then what kind of pair work and group work can you give? And how will you monitor? How will you give individual feedback? So what students actually expect, we may not be able to give. Even if we want to, we cannot give. It's very difficult in a way. I don't know in the future, because of this e-learning, certain things will become possible. Then grouping, this is a major difference actually between two sectors. Grouping is based on the level of English in the private sector. Irrespective of your age, irrespective of your qualifications, degrees, experience, the group is based on your competence, your current level of English, your entry level English, we call it. Whereas in the formal sector, usually it is age-based. If you go to any classroom in India and see students, most of them will be similar in ages. So in fact, the ages are the same, but the level of English is different. And that is a big challenge for teachers in the formal sector. I have faced that problem. Classrooms are generally air-conditioned and cozy in the private sector. In the formal sector, it is sometimes not possible. Looking at the size of our population in India and the classrooms, and it is probably not possible everywhere. But that does have an impact on the outcome of the classroom. Then technology, the use of technology in ELT, it is a routine practice. In the formal sector, probably in the recent past, because of this current crisis that we have been facing, many schools and colleges have started using technology in their classroom teaching, right? In virtual classrooms. But in ELT, in the private sector, it has always been a norm. It was a routine practice. There is nothing new. Whereas in the formal sector, I have seen many computer labs, language labs in some schools and colleges, totally untouched, like graveyards of machines. So we talked about study material, classrooms, and now we talk about our favorite students. Now I am showing you two groups of students, and the teacher is the same in both. You can see on the left-hand side how I was 20 years ago with a lot of hair on my head. And on the right-hand side, it is my recent picture. Now, students. In the private sector, students are highly motivated, because they are coming there by, they are going to a class for by choice. They want to learn something. They have some clear-cut ideas about what they are going to get. So they are highly motivated. They probably know about their needs also. They are very clear. Whereas in the formal sector, it is just the whole bunch from 6th standard to 7th standard, 7 to 8, like that. So it's not everyone is that motivated. Students are goal-oriented also. For example, if a student comes to a private center, coaching center, then he knows that he requires 7.5 bands in IELTS. He requires, say, 100 score in TOEFL examination. He wants, say, 65 in PTE. So he is very clear about his goal. And all the efforts are directed towards that particular goal. Whereas in the formal sector, the top few, they are goal-oriented, but the rest are generally not that goal-oriented. Exceptions are there everywhere. These are all generalizations. In the private sector, the student will compete with himself. He is not going to bother about others, because he is going to appear for a test, for example, IELTS, and he has to compare his yesterday's score with today's score. So he's competing with himself. Whereas in the formal sector, there is always competition with others. Nowadays, actually, it is good that many schools have stopped giving ranks, rank 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like that. Instead of that, we are giving, say, grades. So that is a good sign. In the private sector, students usually ask their queries. Because the size of the class is small, the number of students is small, that's why they ask questions and it becomes a routine thing. Whereas I remember when I was a student, it was very difficult for me to gather courage and ask a question. And sometimes I feel that this question may be very easy. Everyone knows the answer. So I would be, you know, considered stupid. So I don't ask. So in the formal sector, only some select students keep asking their queries. In the private sector, it is possible, because of a small group of students, to give personalized feedback, and then it becomes a norm. Whereas with a larger group, it is always difficult. I just hope that this new ways of using technology will help in this particular feature. And personalized feedback is so important, especially when you talk about, say, writing skill. If you are teaching editing, then without giving personalized guidance, it is almost impossible to teach editing. Stakes are also very high in the private sector. I will give you an example. A few months ago, I got an inquiry from a student. That student had a BE, a mechanical engineer, right? A person who was about to start his career. And he came to make an inquiry, and he came with his parents. Can you imagine? So to that level, stakes are involved. Very high stakes. They know that the student's future is dependent on that particular result. Whereas in the formal sector, stakes are not that high usually, except the board examinations. So parents usually go to their children's school probably 3-4 times a year, right? So parents' involvement is not as much as it is in the private sector. And that's why private sector teachers are always on their toes. And in the private sector, you will have noticed that there is a lot of stress on productive skills. Now, I'm going by a very general definition. I'm not going into the research-based definitions of productive skills. In that sense, every skill is productive. But here, speaking and writing, because these two skills are tested, these two skills are given a lot of importance. Whereas in the formal sector, it is sometimes, even if the teacher wants, it is not possible to do. Right? If you want to make students speak, for example, then you cannot make 80 students come on the stage one by one and speak. Right? Even pair work and group work, it is very difficult to teach these two particular skills. And one point which I have not mentioned here is especially when I'm looking at the slide of speaking, student talk is one of the topics which is taught in all private sector like classes. Student talk, that means if you have a question, how will you ask? How will you talk to your friends? How will you talk probably at home also? So that student talk is one of the major topics in the private sector teaching. Whereas in the formal sector, generally it is not given that much importance, right? Now I can keep on speaking for an hour, but I don't think I should continue because I'm sure there are quite a few questions that we need to handle, respond to. But one thing at the end I would like to say, just one thing, which the private sector does not have now and perhaps will never have is an association like INET and members like you. That is for sure. Now, at the end, if you ask me, is there any conclusion? Then I will say, sorry, there is no conclusion. Any suggestion? Probably yes. Introducing entrepreneurial. Oh, that's a very interesting word, entrepreneurial. It is actually a tongue twister also for many. So introducing entrepreneurial aspects such as autonomy, flexibility, and incentive in the formal sector may help improve the overall quality. Right. So that's from me. Thank you very much. And I look forward to questions. And I will stop sharing the screen. Yes, over to Krishna or Nadeem.
Thank you very much, sir. Very effective talk. And there are so many questions here in my mind. But let's go to Dr. Krishna Dikshit, sir, first.
Yes.
Okay. So thank you very much, Dharmendra bhai, for such a wonderful and stimulating presentation.
Thank you.
Krishna, sir, can we have your video, please?
Oh, sorry. Right. So I like the way you compared this ELE, English language education, as it happens in private sector and in formal sector. So points of comparisons, I mean, I think each one has the potential to be explored into greater depth.
Very true.
But there are a few things that would be really great if you could elaborate on. For example, at one point you said that use of technology has always been there in the private sector compared to, let's say, in public sector. So, I mean, what kind of technology was used and for what purposes and to what effect? I mean, I can guess that, okay, to what effect is a redundant thing, but what kind of technology and for what purposes?
Yeah, thank you for that question, Krishna. Mm-hmm. Now, let me make it clear at the outset that I have a very limited experience. So whatever I say is based on my surrounding and my background and my state.
Yeah.
So it may not be applicable everywhere. But let me talk about a particular area, cassettes. How many of you have seen cassettes? Most of you, right? Audio cassettes.
Yeah.
Now, I remember in Surat, we in Surat and in Navsari and probably in Baroda also, there were many private coaching centers. They started using audio cassettes to teach English. And at that time, probably nobody had even heard of such or even thought of using such material in teaching. Right? Another point, as a side dish, again, I can say, most of the language lab material today used in India, it is from the private sector.
Right.
So that is possible only because they have more exposure to technology. In fact, I have, I should not name, but I have studied at many places where we had language labs, but it was always locked. I have given lectures on, you know, topics related to teaching pronunciation via language laboratories. But at that time also, only for a day or two, it is open and then again, nothing.
Okay.
So we have some problems, definitely. We must accept them.
Yeah, I mean, most of us who are watching this presentation can follow this, what you are saying. Because in most of the institutions, all these things are there only for the purposes of inspection.
Right.
So they need to show that, okay, these facilities are available.
But one thing has happened recently because of this current crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Teachers have started taking tremendous interest in technology.
Yes.
Let me give you my personal example. The day the first phase of lockdown was announced, next day morning, I got a phone call from a group of teachers and they wanted me to train them teaching online. And in fact, in the place where I am from, Surat, in Surat, we have a very active academic association, Surat Academic Association. So it's a group of teachers in the private sector. And they invited me to give a talk. So in fact, I prepared a video for them and uploaded, and I also conducted a session. And many teachers have started using technology. That's a very good sign. I'm very happy about that, at least.
Yeah, definitely. I also read last month somewhere that it's teachers, it's their own initiative that they are struggling and they are finding ways,
right,
I mean, to address in these difficult circumstances.
Right.
So it's teacher initiative, definitely. So another thing that is a little intriguing to me is about the quality, the notion of quality and accountability in private sector teaching. So as we all know that there are so many mechanisms to ensure this quality and accountability in formal sector. And you've hinted at this in your presentation. You said that it's the outcome, the result determines the quality. So here I would like to know, do you follow any templates or any models to ensure this quality in your teaching and training?
I would not say just about me, but in the
entire sector.
There is no particular format that anyone follows. It is purely market driven.
Okay.
And in fact, if you say quality of teaching, that is decided by the outcome in terms of students' performance. So for example, 10 students from my place, if they score 7.5 plus in IELTS band, then I'll be considered better. So it is purely student result based. There is no external quality check kind of thing. And in fact, that is the reason why there are many problems also in the private sector. For example, as I mentioned in my earlier talk, that a science graduate, for example, a commerce graduate, for example, that person will start teaching. Now the problem is, I'm talking about teaching English. So the problem is when students ask questions about some nuances of the English language, then they will be confused. They will not be able to answer. Right. So, for example, about pronunciation. If some student asks the teacher, what is the pronunciation of the letter U? Any ordinary person would just say U as in put. Now we know that there are so many pronunciations possible. If you take B-U-R-Y, it will be Barry. So there's a pronunciation of the letter U is A. If it is C-U-T, cut, then it is A. So such finer aspects of language, most teachers in the private sector will find difficult to answer. And this is just a simple example, but even in structure, for example, one of the major areas of English, that is word grammar. And in that, those who are not from the formal sector, they will find it very difficult. Like collocation is one of the most difficult topics to teach. I remember in one of the teacher training programs in the private sector when I was invited. So a student asked a question. I did a mistake yesterday. Why is it wrong? And the teacher there, he was confused because he didn't have any answer. He said, no, this is the way we use and this is the way you have to teach. So he could not give proper answer because he was not from the formal sector. And he didn't probably have enough meta language to teach, which formal sector teachers have.
Yeah, absolutely. This one statement that you made in your presentation, that CPD is must for survival in private sector.
Right.
I completely agree with you. And if I had to tell you what happens in formal sector, at least from my point of view, so this is my personal opinion. So you see what's happening is recently, professionals, teachers working in public sector have developed a very strong fascination for CPD. So they have started talking a lot about CPD and of course doing several things in the name of CPD.
Right.
So what's happening? So I may be completely wrong, but this is my observation. To some extent, I would say it's a term abused as well. I'll share an experience. So in one of the sessions that I attended last month, I've been attending quite a few sessions like this. So one of the participants asked the presenter. The presenter was talking about a particular approach to teaching. So there was a question and that really shocked me. The participant asked, is it useful for our CPD? So when I say that this term is abused, so it's coming from a background like this.
Right.
So it would be great if you could share what are the things that people in private sector do for their CPD? For example, you can also tell us, what things that you did in the recent past at CPD?
Oh, great. Thank you. You asked a question. And I think Amul has also asked a question. I'll try to answer at least these two questions.
Yeah.
I will answer your question.
Mm-hmm.
CPD, as you mentioned, it is a daily thing.
Mm-hmm.
Daily thing, almost on a daily basis. We keep learning something new every time. Like I have a small group of teachers and we found that in terms of pronunciation, we have done some work in like we have done practice of sounds and word stress and rhythm and intonation. In spite of doing all these things, something is missing.
Mm-hmm.
So with some friends of mine, we explored that area and we found out that there are so many things that we can learn from voice culture. So many things we can learn from voice acting. In fact, yesterday I attended an Instagram live And that person, he gives so many wonderful tips, which we teachers can learn from. So CPD in the private sector is not limited to ELT only.
Okay, great.
For example, in my institute, just about a year ago, we had a session on theater in ELT. Yeah. Then speech and drama. Right. So we are more open probably in the private sector. People are more open to learning. And another thing, Krishna, I would like to mention, in the private sector, teachers pay to learn. Right. Teachers are paying a handsome amount to learn. They will not look back.
Yeah.
They consider it an investment and it is a survival strategy. Right. And by the way, Amol has asked a question. I would like to answer if I can. In fact, I know Amol has all the answers. He's just asking for the sake of. Yeah, he's my dear friend and mentor. I'm reading Amol's question. Dharmendra, do you think some training in English language and English teaching will benefit private sector teachers? And what kind? Absolutely, absolutely. Amol, one of the things which I have noticed, as I mentioned actually recently, is in the private sector, teachers are generally from various backgrounds. So they do not have a proper grounding in methods and strategies and approaches. So whatever one or two articles they have read on the net, using that they will start teaching. But if people like you can provide proper teaching of methods with pros and cons, and you ultimately no method is the method as such. After you study various methods and then you look at the needs of your students, then you look at capacity of your students, then you look at the materials available, then you look at the time frame available, and keeping in mind all these things, you design a particular program. So that is where private sector teachers lack, because they don't have the information. For them, communicative language teaching means just speaking. You speak in front of students in the target language and they acquire it. And we know that that is not the case. In fact, Krishna might know, when I was in the UK with him, I went to some places where there were Gujarati families, and there were some people who had been living there for 25 years, but they could not hold a normal conversation with me in English. So just using English in front of your classroom, in front of your students, that is not going to make them good users of English. So I think method-related teaching is required in the private sector. And another thing is, there is a lot of time wasted in trying out various materials. So probably if you can provide them training with training in how to create worksheets, what to teach in what, anyone lesson plan, for example, lesson plan is not that, properly maintained in the private sector. I hope partially I have answered your question, and the rest you can add from your side. Any other question?
There are several questions, but we will continue this conversation. I think let's open it up for the audience now.
Yes.
Yes, Nadeem.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for this quick interaction with Dr. Dharmendra, sir. We have Renu Dhotre, ma'am, and I'm going to unmute Renu, ma'am. She will be taking up questions from the Facebook comments. So, Renu, ma'am, all set?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. It's all to you now.
So, Dharmendra, sir.
Yeah.
Two things we have learned: voice culture and the need-based research that you have done. So, smile, feedback, that's very important. And yes, methods of teaching. So these are the things that we have taken up. There are a few questions from the audience.
Okay.
Now, do you think freedom to design and executive activities without proper training works? This is a question from Taufik Zazib.
Can you please repeat that?
Okay. Do you think freedom to design and executive activities without proper training works?
Oh, got it. Now, without training, nothing will work. The problem is, I'm sure many of you will agree with me, that degrees are deceptive. And unfortunately, if you see, for example, in our Indian colleges, if you want to become a teacher of English, for example, then you need to have an MA and a certain percentage and some qualifying examination, and then you become a teacher. You may have learned the content, but how to teach, you have never studied. Right? So there is no training as such in that part. So designing a worksheet, for example, as you were mentioning, Taufik, I forget the name, but designing a worksheet, it is such a Herculean task. It is such a Herculean task. Unless and until you have taught for at least 10 years in a particular setting, you cannot design worksheets for them. So training is a must. And experts like Krishna and Amol, you will have to take their help. Otherwise, you can't do it. I'm lucky that I've got help from experts across the globe. And one of my favorite teachers, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention their names at the beginning. Usually I do it when I have my own presentation in all facilities. Dr. Sudhakar Marathe and Mrs. Marathe, they have guided me throughout my career. In fact, without their support, I wouldn't have been able to achieve anything in my field. So I would like to thank them at this point.
Yes, sir. So we'll take the second question.
Yes.
If this is the situation, I think government should today privatize education sector instead of bothering huge investment in education sector. What do you think? Now, the condition when you compared between the private sector and the informal sector, if this is a condition, what the government should do? Should it privatize everything? What do you think?
Not at all. And I am not probably the right person to make any comment on this. But I think a lot of autonomy is required. Teachers are limited by so many things. And these days, especially in the last 10 years, I have hundreds of friends in the formal sector. So I keep talking to them, listening to their stories. And many teachers, they have confessed that they are wasting a lot of time doing a lot of unproductive things. Many of them, they want to do a lot of work in their field. They want to create new activities. They want to implement, try out. But they are limited by so many things. An examination pattern and textbooks. Oh, my goodness. About textbooks, we can say so much. In fact, about 10 years ago, I was, very active in terms of writing messages and emails and letters to government departments when I was not happy with textbooks. In fact, one of my very close dear friends, Dr. Zedan Patil, I did something for the Gujarat State Textbook Board, and particularly textbooks used for the Gujarati medium students. And Dr. Zedan Patil, he did a lot of work for, I think, textbooks in Maharashtra. And by the way, today it is his birthday. So I would, if he is listening today, I would like to say happy birthday to him. So he also prepared reports suggesting corrections and, a lot of things about the textbooks. But finally, nothing much happened. I'm happy to say that in the recent past, in our state board, there are positive changes. But still, we have a long way to go. A lot is required still. But privatization of education, I will never, ever recommend. What we need is a marriage, a happy marriage between the two. Why can't there be a happy marriage? For example, teachers from the private sector, let them invite them sometime to the formal sector, and the same vice versa. Let's share our practices. Whatever has worked in one field, let's use it in the other field. So probably a marriage is important, a happy marriage between two sectors.
But still, it's a long way to go to have a happy marriage between the private sector and the formal sector.
Can I say something, Renu? Just sorry to interrupt you. Though I agree with you that it is a long way to go, but many things have started happening. For example, if I talk about Gujarat, then in Gujarat, in many schools, they have started keeping a special language improvement class, and that is conducted by teachers outside. So especially we are lucky that in our field, something positive is happening. In many schools, in fact, they keep on contacting me again and again. They ask me to suggest some online material, some language lab material, some worksheets, some course books. So there is a happy marriage. It is like it. I'm sure it will happen very soon. But that's positive. Yeah, Renu.
So let's be positive.
Yes.
So there's one question. What's the difference between an English teacher and an English trainer?
With my limited knowledge, I will say training is a limited term, whereas a teacher is a much larger term. A teacher encompasses everything. It is not just content knowledge that a teacher is giving. In fact, in our Indian tradition, we have a word guru, right? So teaching a particular subject or teaching a skill, trainers normally they talk about a skill, and trainers would probably have a limited goal. There may be a particular event, for example, and you might get some training for that particular event. But teachers have a larger role to play. That's what I feel.
But teachers also work on skills.
Definitely.
Like when we talk.
Do everything. In fact,
okay.
Earlier when I was a student, people used to say those who can't do anything, they become teachers. Now today I would say those who can do everything, that person can only become a teacher.
Yeah, there may be a transition. Yeah. But what I realized from this, your answer is, in private sector, a lot of stress is given on the skill of the students, rather than taking everything into, encompassing everything.
I agree with you. Yes, yes. Because ultimately, the students, they have a particular requirement. It is purely based on needs. It is market driven. What they want, we are supplying.
True.
And in fact, in those who attended my mini session at the INET conference in Hyderabad last year, at that time, I mentioned at the beginning that in the formal sector, teachers, they do a lot of work for years and years and years. And at the end, the student goes to a private sector and just 3, 4, 5 months of study, and those private sector people, they get the credit. The foundation was laid actually in the formal sector.
Yeah. True. There's a question from Sandeep Jadhav. Okay. We are aware about limitations of implementing activities in formal sector. Have you explored and found any quick fix for it? I'm repeating the question.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. Fixes are impossible in any field, and ELT is no exception. Right. So the only thing which I see as a positive sign is certain things which you were not able to do earlier in the classroom, now you are able to do because of technology. I'll give you a very simple example. Like you want your students to speak something and you want to listen to them and then you want to give feedback. Now in a normal classroom of 35 minutes, and if you have 40 students, let's take only 40. So if you have 40 students and if you want to listen to 40 students and make comments, is it possible? It is not possible.
No.
Now, because of the technology, you can ask students to record it and send it to you via WhatsApp or email. So technology, I see as a boon here. In fact, this morning, those who are on my list, broadcast list for English language materials, I gave an activity today. Somebody forwarded me a picture, and there was a man with stretched hands and legs. And on one side, there was Facebook, and then Twitter, and then YouTube, and something like that. So I liked that picture, and I sent it to all my students. And I said, please write a paragraph of 10 lines on that picture. Now,
that doesn't happen.
Huh? Sorry?
Continue, sir.
Yeah. So when they submit their answers, I will have a chance to read and make comments individually. So technology is probably going to help us all. Yes, Renu.
In the formal sector also. Like yes. Since we have shifted to online, so I feel now technology can help the formal teachers in bringing about a change. Now, you take learners from different age groups.
Yes.
Kids or... So, who are better? learners, kids or adults?
I haven't come across any bad learner in my life so far.
So no one is bad learners, but still, what's the experience? Because you are you're attending with all sorts of learners, all age group.
In my classroom, it is always a mixed ability group, because Krishna might agree with me that the definition of mixed ability is when you have two students in the classroom. So even if it will be a mixed ability class, right? So I have always had that kind of group. Age wise also different. But one thing I have noticed, if you love teaching, students will enjoy, irrespective of their background, irrespective of their level of English, right? Irrespective of even their needs, but they will enjoy. And we are
lucky. So that means,
we are lucky in English language teaching that the English language affords so many opportunities to us. If you study nuances of the English language, you can use them again and again, and you can make your class interesting. And every state, for example, will have interesting things to share. For example, if you take my place, Surat, then many people have a problem with sa and sha. Mm. So same and shame are the same for many. Mm. Right. So like that, you can find certain things from the language, and you can make your classroom interesting.
Yeah. So I feel since you're dealing with students of all the age group, you have gained a lot of experience in dealing with them.
Yeah, you can see that.
This is the last question from Arindam Sengupta. Don't you think there should be some reward for teachers in the long run who walk the extra mile? Like, he's definitely talking about the one who passionately do some CPD, and they're trying to bring the sort of informal structure in the formal setup. So do you feel
absolutely
they should be rewarded?
Absolutely. In fact, if you saw my last slide, in which I mentioned some of the entrepreneurial aspects, if they can be brought into the formal sector, it will definitely help. It has to be brought. And Arindam Sengupta, I know him very well. He is one of the fantastic teachers of English. And I fully agree with his view.
Thank you very much, sir, for joining us for this Facebook Live. This was the second in the series. And very insightful answers and very good interaction between all. Thank you to all the INET team members, INET Connect associates, and the audiences who are here with us on Facebook. Let's call it a day. Thank you very much, Dr. Dharmendra Sheth, sir. Thank you.
My pleasure.